Hey, good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to the Chicago Bible Study. We are here and we are so happy to have an opportunity to share with you. And you know, every time we come to open up and share the Word of God, we're just blessed. We're blessed. So to all of those who are joining us for the first time, welcome to this conversation. For those who are repeats, welcome again. You know, we hope you would leave inspired to study God's Word more. We hope you would leave encouraged to live according to God's Word. We hope you will leave determined to have a closer relationship with our big brother and our friend, Jesus Christ. And we hope you will leave with some answers to some of life's most pressing questions regarding God's Word. You know, we are always excited to have a dynamic panel. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to allow them to introduce themselves. But first, let me introduce myself. I'm Jose Wilson, and I'm just so excited to be here today and to be joined by this dynamic group of men and women. We're going to start to my far left and your far right, and then we're going to end with a young lady who we haven't seen here for a while, so that's why I'm saving her for last, all right? We're going to start with Elder Mike. Mike?
My name is Michael Duncan, elder here at the Shiloh Church. My name is Michael Duncan, elder here at the Shiloh Church.
Listen, y'all, that's real-time feedback. So we have, if you didn't hear that, so we have a live audience here, and so we appreciate their interaction. All right, we'll continue.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. I'm Christina Wells, and I'm just excited. I'm just blessed to have woken this morning, yeah. And I'm just blessed to be here this morning and to be able to share. I just want to say that this has been a wonderful lesson, and for anyone who wants to get down to the finish line, don't forget we still have our Psalms challenge. So you only have one more week to get your Psalms in, and please send it to health@lrcsda.com. Again, health@lrcsda.com. I'd love to read some Psalms next week as we wrap up this lesson. And I also want to say, starting April 1, we are starting our 21-day fitness challenge. We'll have the flyer up there next Sabbath by God's grace, and we're going to start our fitness challenge. So for those who are here at Shiloh, see me, because we need teams. So I want to get you guys signed up. So we're going to do this fitness challenge. It's going to be great. And for those who are at other churches or other places, get your teams together. Sign up. The team who has the most points is going to be the LRC Made to Move champion. So again, we're going to have this fitness challenge. We have someone who's making some wonderful videos for us. We're going to post those on Facebook. So again, more information next week to join our fitness challenge. And thank you guys for allowing me the time to make that announcement.
Now, Christine, you mean that's going to be like a conference-wide event?
A conference-wide challenge.
Well, listen, the challenge has gone out, Rachel. You know, we're challenging anybody a part of any other church. We, I think, can take home the gold.
Let's go, Shiloh.
All right. Listen, we haven't seen this young lady for a while. And man, to Rachel, to Wayne and the family, man, we love y'all so much and been praying for you. And we're so glad that she could join us today. So we're going to let her introduce herself and welcome her back to the panel. Rachel!
Amen. My name is Rachel Odle, and just so grateful to be here this morning and to be back with my family. As you guys know, we have been going through a lot with the loss of my mother-in-law, and we are so, so grateful for the outpouring of love, the support, the prayers that we've been receiving from our church family and from our online family. Yeah. I mean, it has really been such a blessing. And so I just want to thank you guys for that. Thank you so much. And we're just praising God for a worship that never ends. Y'all, this is a hope. This is a hopeful message this week. So I'm excited.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Welcome back. And so we're going to kick it off. Listen, we're going to ask Christine. Christine, you want to go ahead and give us a word of prayer to open us up? And let's get started.
All right. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, thank you for this blessed Sabbath day. Thank you for your love, for your grace, for your mercy. Lord God, thank you for the opportunity to offer worship that never ends. Lord God, may your Holy Spirit dwell in our mouths and dwell in the ears of our listeners. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. What a title to start off with. Worship that never ends. And here, I have a question just to kick us off. Panel, it's a soft question. Those also who are in the chat online, I don't know about you, but it seemed like this week, Elder Mike, it's been challenging, man. And I think for me a little bit more. Like, you know, every week, every time we get up, there's things that takes place and we get challenged by them. And so for me, this lesson was so timely because it talks about, it says a worship that never ends. So have y'all had a challenging week? I mean, I'm just gonna give you a chance to check in real quick because I think sometimes, you know, you may see us here and we try to keep this as real as possible and as practical as possible because, you know, we don't wanna be those people who are on the panel, those people who seem like they got it all together. You know, we wanna be those people who are struggling like you may be struggling with real life issues that show up from time to time. And so I'm gonna read the scripture and then get the panel just to respond to, you know, has the week been challenging? And then and anchored in that, how might this lesson have blessed you this week? Does that make sense, panel? All right, and so the scripture that we're kind of anchored in is found in Psalms 104 and 33, and we're reading a New King James Version, and it reads, I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. And what a declaration that is. What a declaration to say, I will sing as long as I live, praise to the Lord. Panel, anyone want to talk to that question, just the week for you this week, so we can let folks know that, man, we are real people up in here, in this place, and that we rely on the Lord to get us through. And even before we started the panel conversation, we just made a declaration. It's been challenging. So anybody want to respond real quick to that and how the lesson might have been a blessing for you this week?
I just wanted to say too, and you know, we always help everyone out here that if you need a copy of the lesson,
thank you. Yes.
Go to absg.adventist.org. Again, that's absg.adventist.org, or come visit one of your local Seventh-day Adventist churches to get a hard copy because you don't want to miss it. And there's a lot in the lesson that we don't go through. We're bringing out what the Holy Spirit reveals to us, and the Holy Spirit might reveal something different to you. But to your answer, Elder Jose, you know, I had a tough week this week. But I praise God despite it because I am blessed. Mm. And so when I think about the worship that never ends, I think about that in each and every moment, I have to be grateful for what I have. And one of the things we have to know is that there are so many people who are passing away.
Right,
tomorrow is not promised. Today, while we have breath, we have to praise God. But praising God, again, goes way beyond singing songs and praying prayers. It is the way I live every day of my life. And so I want to read this verse really quick. It's Psalms 104, verses 33 through 34. And I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation. It says, I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God to my last breath.
Wow.
May all my thoughts be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. And as I thought about that, this hit home for me. And I said, it's not just my actions, but it's my very thoughts that should praise God. And so I said, you know what, Lord, help me not only to praise you with my lips, but help me to praise you with my thoughts.
Come on now, right. Now see, that's deep. So that's, Christine, that's powerful because I think oftentimes, you know, we judge people what we see. And so like based on what we wear, you know, based on what we say, but man, isn't it something though to ask God to really help us control our thinking, you know, which actually is the origin of our thoughts and the things coming out of our mouths. So powerful, powerful. Panel, any other responses?
So again, echoing that same sentiment, you know, our worship is more than just singing. It's more than just waving your hands or shouting a hallelujah. Worship is an everyday practice. Yeah. And that means that worship is supposed to be in place despite the situation that you're in, despite the circumstances that you find yourselves. Worship is what connects you to your awareness of who God is. And that's one thing that I love about this lesson. It goes on in Psalm 15 in verse 4, and it says that he who honors those who fear the Lord, they revere and they worship him, who swears to his own hurt, but he does not change.
He doesn't change. Wow.
That part is so powerful, because when you have a heart of worship, like Christina just said, when you have your mind stayed on Christ, then no matter what hurt you acknowledge in your life, no matter what physical malady, no matter what emotional burden you bear, you won't change because your heart has stayed on Christ. You know that God's got me. You know that, like Job, no matter what has gone on, my God, his love, his strength is sufficient. You are able to say, like Esther or like the Hebrew boys and so many that have come before us, well, if I perish, I perish. If my God has called me somewhere, it might be for such a time as this. No matter what you are going through, God is still good. And it is his goodness that commands us to worship. Not our circumstance, but the goodness of our God.
Amen.
You know, that sounds
Amen.
Like we got to have an experience with God to really understand that to his fullness. And I think about in the summary of the study, it talks about just a couple things stood out. One, it's the worship is the creature's response to the gift of the creator. It's what we do because God has created us. And that two biblical truths kind of stands out. One is that God has given many blessings to humanity. Would you agree, Connell, that God has given many blessings? He's given many blessings to humanity. And so then these blessings, then they should awaken inside of us a gratitude in our hearts of what God has done and how great he is. It should. And you know, one of the questions I had was, I'm like, I wonder why it is the case that it does not seem to. I'm not saying that some of us may not display it externally, you don't have it, but it seemed like maybe not, based on our response and what we tend to see. The second thing is, human beings are endowed with an innate predisposition to respond to the wonders of God with adoration. And so I'm like, okay, so if that's true, and I believe it is, then why don't we? Why aren't we? And so a couple things came up to me, panel, and I was just thinking that, you know how we can be conditioned? Sister Rachel, I'm thinking about Pablo,
yes.
Right? You know, and his condition of his dogs. And so, listen, first of all, I don't get any texts or emails, or don't try to pull up on your brother. I'm not calling anybody dogs. But here's an example. But you can train a dog to do anything. Yeah, you got some animals, man, that have been trained to some remarkable things, working with police, you know, working. If you've been to the airport, you have dogs in the airport, they've been trained to go to some police stations or actually transit depots in Chicago, New York, and other places, you see the same. So I'm wondering that, are we sometimes, as believers, conditioned not to praise God in a way that the lesson talks about? We're going to get into some of that a little bit later on. But we think about, are we conditioned? You know, how do you condition people? Through punishments and rewards. Like you punish for things you don't want to see and you reward for things you do. And so I was just thinking, you know, man, I wonder that collectively as a church body, have we been conditioned to respond a certain way? The lesson that we're going to go through is going to touch on the following. So worship in the sanctuary, we're going to touch on that. Worship with a new song. Oh, man, I just know that when we are with the Lord, he will give us a new song. Also, the worship of the righteous. Also, multi-form worship. And then worship in the spirit and in truth. And so one of the things that came across to me in the study was that we should learn to worship with all of our hearts. Then I asked the question, what does that really mean? Like, what does it really mean to worship with all your heart? What does it really mean for us to give God our hearts? And so it means this to me. And the panel, you guys can respond if you have any thoughts. But it means this to me. It means that we are sincere. It means we are honest. It means we are intentional. It means we are methodical. It means that we are obedient. And guess what? You did not hear from me. You didn't anything say about how I feel. No, I choose to because of what he has done for me. And because of the relationship I have established over the years, I choose to because I know that he is faithful. And so when we think about giving God our hearts, we're saying giving him our very best. It's giving him every single thing. And with that, there is approval from him because he knows that we have left nothing on the table, right, that can compete with him, and he is indeed first. Panel, any really quick thoughts about, you know, those comments? If that is okay, we're going to move on. Any thoughts? All right. So listen. Elmite, go ahead.
I just wanted to echo what Rachel said. Our circumstances may change, but the fact that God deserves our worship and praise never changes. I shared with Dr. Wells that last week the company I work for had a layoff. 400 people lost their jobs, including my supervisor. I know what that feels like because I experienced it in 2017. Last week, I learned that one of my coworkers passed away, one of the most important members of our team, and so we're grieving that loss. And then this past week, I'm in the process of picking up responsibilities that are really out of my wheelhouse. They are not my area of expertise. But in spite of that, I say, as Habakkuk chapter 3 says, I will rejoice in the Lord. God is faithful.
Amen. Thank you, Mike, for sharing that. You know, and we talked earlier just about, you know, we are people who have real life circumstances. And one thing that is consistent with those who I serve with here and also in our church is that people have relationships with the Lord and that we are truly seeing him show up in our lives in any and every situation. And so there's something that came across to me in the lesson. It says, you know, lift up your hands in the sanctuary. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary. How many people lift their hands up in the sanctuary? You know, why would he even do that? Why would we do that? We've been commanded to lift our hands up, you know, in the sanctuary. You know, the priests back in the day would lift their hands up and they would worship God, but they were also blessed people, right? And so then the priests who had that responsibility, you know, of going to the sanctuary, performing a variety of services. But y'all, guess who the priests are today? Yeah, we are. We are the priests. As a matter of fact, the word tells us that we are, in Peter, we are a royal priesthood, right? We're a royal priesthood, so we are the priests. And guess what these bodies are? These are temples. We're talking, we're those temples, right? And so when we think about lifting our hands up, we talked earlier about some reason why maybe we don't in certain places. When we're told to lift our hands in the sanctuary and praise God, because what we studied was this, check this out, is that when Israel lifted their hands up and when they praised God, guess what, panel? Something happened. Yeah. All right, y'all, come on, somebody know. When praises goes up, come on now. Now, is God faithful like that, though? Is he faithful like that? Yes. So then it's like, you think about it. Why don't we do that? I think that sometimes we get conditioned corporately to be silent. I think sometimes we get conditioned sometimes to not do those things that the word has asked us and requires us to do. And the last thing I will say is that as we think about this, we are challenged to make sure that it doesn't matter, we heard earlier, the situation or circumstances. Because see, what I've learned is this, is that once I have created a behavior, all right, in any situation, then I have learned, I'm a living testimony that no matter the situation, I have learned to praise God, to lift my hands when things are going well. I've learned, and this took some time. Listen, panel, I don't know about y'all. Like, this took some time. Those who are watching online and those who are here in our sanctuary, I didn't wake up with this mindset, with this change of heart of mine. I grew into it. So then at every challenging, Dr. Wells, every challenging opportunity that I've had, Rachel, Michael, I've learned at that moment was a time to trust God. Has anybody ever experienced that before? It's like at that moment. And so then what happens is, over time, I've learned that, hey, when things are taking place, no matter what it is, man, I've learned to trust the Lord. Last example real quick. So I have this vehicle that I purchased recently. And I'm like, you know, it's relatively new. Maybe I'm the only one that can relate to that. It's relatively new. So it's not 2020. It's newish. It's newish. And man, this car, it's a Subaru. Let me call the brand. I'm not promoting Subaru, but it is a good car. Man, listen, all the lights start to flash on that mug. Yeah, all the lights. It's lit up like a Christmas tree. I'm like, wait a minute, I just got this car. And so, but at that moment, and I knew I was growing, I had grown in Christ. Because heretofore, in years past, you know what your brother would have done? Man, I would have panicked. I would have panicked. You know, my heart would start racing, anxiety would kick in, and I would start just creating stuff in my head. And so, but now my response was this. I was like, stop. First, take a deep breath, reconnect my frontal lobe so I can think and so I can worship. And then I prayed and said, God, you got this, move forward. And so when I took it into a dealership, the expense that I was expecting was not as great as I thought. Praise the Lord. And from that time to now, it's been just fine. As a matter of fact, you know, I was able to drive to Montgomery, Alabama and back, and also to Tampa, Florida and back with a trailer. Right? Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely. So God is good. God is good. So panel, any thoughts, anything that came up for you regarding, you know, that part of the study? We talked about raising our hands in the sanctuary. Any thoughts, any ideas you want to share at this time?
I just would say that I think that we have to always be grateful for what we have. You know, things could always be better. Things could always be worse. Yeah. And so I think that we always have to think about what God has given us. Even, again, the ability to be in our right mind, the ability to be able to breathe is a blessing. And so I think that we always have to think about that and be grateful for what God has given us. I'll probably tell you guys a little bit more about this, but I'm gonna be gone for a little bit because I'm going on a mission trip to Papua New Guinea. And as I think about, you know, all the mission trips, and then I'm gonna go to Australia as well, praise the Lord. I think about the blessings that God has given us. And sometimes we don't think about how fortunate we are until we're going and seeing other places and what people don't have. And so I think every time we want That's to think point. About and complain yeah. about what we don't have and how yeah. bad our circumstances are, we have to think about that there's someone who's struggling and be grateful for what God has given us.
Amen. Thanks, Dr. Wells. Thank Amen. You.
I love the idea of conditioning ourselves.
Yeah.
We talk about training, you said, like with dogs or animals, but the truth is we train our minds every single day. With every decision that we make, with everything that we look at, what we are reading, what we are listening to, what we are watching, the things that we are consuming consume us. And we have to be so mindful and be so intentional
yeah.
about where we place our thoughts,
yeah.
placing our minds.
Yeah.
You know, we say, oh man, God is good, and we praise him when things are happy and when things are great. But when things get difficult, because we have not practiced
That's
giving
right.
thanksgiving in all things, yeah. then we fall short. And we sit there and we say, oh no, I don't know what to do. All the lights are going off. Father, help me, right? We don't know. We don't know where to go. We don't know how to have joy or how to experience peace even in the midst of our storms. And I think sometimes we just have to shift a little bit of our thinking, shift a little bit of our perspective, because as much as we say we want to have trust in God, we have to remember that in order to build trust, we have to have experiences that require it. In order to build perseverance, we have to go through things that require perseverance. In order to build strength, confidence, love, compassion, on down the list, we have to be in experiences that require us to dig deep and find those things. Yeah. We have to look at our challenges, at our difficult moments, and say, you know what? Lord, you've just provided me with an opportunity for growth.
Yeah, yeah.
If we approach it with in mind, Father, how can I grow in this? Because right now I really want to punch this person in the nose, but I'm sure you might not want me to do that, right? How can I practice forgiveness? How can I practice empathy? How can I identify with where someone is, what they might be experiencing, even though I might not have gone through that exact same thing myself? We have to empty ourselves of ourselves and ask God to fill it back up with Him. It's so important to be intentional, so important to shift your thinking. And I love that the last part here, that the lesson highlights how God, He shows Himself in His sanctuary. The sanctuary is, and it says that the Israelites didn't see God, right? He was invisible, but that the sanctuary served to reflect the glory of God and to provide that secure environment. Guys, when you come into the sanctuary, you are coming into the arms of Christ. You are coming into the closeness of your God. So even in your mind, train yourself that in your thoughts, when you're in your car and something happens, you close your eyes and go to the sanctuary. You run to Him and feel safe and secure. He will cover you. Let your intention be set on God, and He will make everything else fall in line.
Amen. 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 You know something? Because He's in the sanctuary. Yeah. Yeah. Think about it. When we connect in that way, Rachel, we're connected with Him. He's in the sanctuary. Let me read these three scriptures real quick. Psalms 134 is a very short Psalms, very powerful and impactful. Let me read that for you real quick. It says in Psalms 134:1, it says, "Behold, bless ye the Lord, all ye servants of the Lord, which by night stand in the house of the Lord." Verse 2, "Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord." And verse 3 says, "The Lord that made heaven and earth, bless thee out of Zion." And you know something? And I'm going to pass the torch in a second. I was thinking that, you know, when we raise our hands, like, what does that really indicate? Because I thought, Mike, I thought when we raise our hand like this, right, unto heaven, like, what in society does that indicate? One, it indicates surrender. Yeah, yeah, and some, you know, listen, now, hey, now listen, I live on the south side of Chicago. If you are as I am, get the point? Yeah, there's a time that you need to raise your hands and surrender. Yeah, and so for us, it's also a sign of victory. And so we think about raising our hands, a sign of surrender. It's a sign of victory. You know, it's a sign of celebration. It's a sign of blessing. And, you know, think about the different venues that we see people. Man, it's amazing to me. And I'm going to say this, and my heart goes out to all the Bears fans. You know, Justin Fields gets traded to the Pittsburgh Steelers. And I know some folks are sad about that, right? Now, other folks are celebrating. And either way, what it reminds me of is that there are times, y'all, that we are celebrating in spaces and raising our hands. And I'm like, man, how do you get that excited? And I played the sport, and I don't get that excited by the sport. I mean, I played it. I played at the highest, next to the highest level. And so I see folks, man, raising their hand. What sport venue do you go to? They don't raise their hand, they're shouting. You think about it. I'm saying the enthusiasm is just so for me, it was a striking contrast. I'm thinking about this text reads, the Lord that made heaven and earth bless thee out of Zion. So we saying we can't get that excited. So listen, y'all, let's get excited for the Lord. Let's praise him, because when the blessing goes up, when the praise goes up, the blessing comes down. They come down, they come down, they come down. All right, we're going to pass the torch over to our next panelist, and she's going to take us to a whole nother level. Go right ahead.
Yes, and when that blessing comes down, we can sing to the Lord a new song.
Yes,
amen?
Yes, yes.
And so
yes.
I'm going to read here from Psalm 96. And this is worshiping the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Mm. And it says, oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the people are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O family of families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Mm. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness.
Wow.
So each day we should sing a new song to God that reflects the deliverance we receive day by day. Because whether you believe it or not, or think about it or not, every day we are delivered from something. The things we see and the things that we don't see. This new song reflects the majesty and sovereignty of the Lord and our gratitude for his care and salvation. And so we're going to do something here, okay? I want you guys, if you think about this, you know, and you can feel free to shout it out, but we're going to do a name that tune. We're going to think about the wonderful grace and mercy of God and the songs that reflect God. And so this new song, right, we're talking about singing to the Lord a new song. Mm. And so even those online, just reflect about these songs, because I know all of them are going to be familiar to you. So this new song reflects God as creator. And it says, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. This new song reflects God as King. Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Rejoice, give thanks and sing, and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice. This new song reflects our trust in God. When we walk in the Lord, in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will what?
Trust
and obey. This new song praises God for his wonderful works. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. This new song praises God for his deliverance. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. You see, God has given us these songs. I praise God that when I thought about this last night, I said, you know, I'm going to sing these new songs. And I didn't want to sing it because I wanted you to really get the essence of me emphasizing those words through me speaking it. And we've got to put those songs in our hearts so that in times that are coming and in times even now, we can be reminded, and it goes back to what Rachel was saying earlier, when we don't practice it now, it's the Holy Spirit will not be able to bring it to our remembrance in those times when we need it. And so we've got to stay in the Word. We've got to put those songs in our hearts. And so you have a song. So I sang some songs that we're familiar with, but you have a song that is uniquely yours and reflects your testimony. Part of it may start off as, I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Filled with the Holy Ghost, I am. All my sins are washed away. I've been redeemed.
Yeah.
True worship, again, goes beyond sacrifices and offerings and reflects a living relationship with God that is always fresh and dynamic. I like that the Sabbath school lesson says that. In a sense, one could simply say that the new song is a new expression even each day of our love and appreciation for what God has done for us. And this is the most amazing thing. One day, when we leave this earth, we will sing a whole new song. Revelation 5 verse 9 through 10 says, and they sang a new song of glorious redemption, saying, worthy and deserving are you to take the scroll and to break its seals. For you were slain, sacrificed, and with your blood you purposed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom of royal subjects and priests to our God, and they will reign on the earth. I can't wait. What about you? For that day when we will sing a new song that no one else will know, but a new song except for those who have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And so I want to let my panelists, I know we have a few minutes here before we move on. What did you think about singing a new song to the Lord?
Man, I like to sing. You know, although I don't sing well, you know, I'm not Rachel, I'm not, you know, Christine. Mike, do you sing? Mike, I don't know. Mike, we the same. Mike, so Mike and I, the brother's struggling up here singing. But you know something? I like singing. I enjoy singing. And so there's a song I heard. It was sang at an event, and you know, it was the authors, Mary, can't give up now.
That's right.
Oh, come on now. So some of y'all know. It's so important. Like that is embedded in my. When I heard that song, it spoke to a situation that I was dealing with, and I'm like, praise the Lord. It's like, hold on now, he's brought you too far, and then I remember to claim some promises, right? He would never leave nor forsake, and then you know something? It lifted my spirit. I felt the Holy Spirit come down and just calm your brother down. So Dr. Wells, thank you for sharing that. I mean, those songs, it's like, Dr. Wells, old school. Y'all heard those songs, right? And those hymns are so powerful. And some of us have experienced other songs. Put them in your heart. So then at those moments where you have, where we have situations that pop up, sometimes, y'all, out of nowhere, we can rely on those songs and also the Word.
In Revelation 14 and verse 3, the Bible speaks of a song that only the 144,000 are able to sing. And when I look at that text, what I discover is the reason why they are the only ones able to sing that song is because they have a unique experience.
Come on.
The other thought that comes to my mind is that the highest form of praise or worship is obedience. Blessing is the outcome and not the goal of a relationship with God. The difference between false religion and true religion, which is really what Revelation 14 is ultimately all about. We think about the mark of the beast and the seal of God. It comes down to this issue. Are we worshiping and serving God, or are we using God?
Oh, wow. Wow.
And using God is the essence of idolatry.
Wow.
Amen. Amen.
That's powerful, Mike. That's, yeah, man. Hey, listen, that's the question. We are tasked to ask ourselves that question. Because you know what came up, Mike, for me was sometimes we can treat God like a genie.
I was just gonna say that.
Go ahead, Dr. Wells. Go ahead. You're like a genie in a bottle, right? You know, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Man, it's like, and we can get caught into that behavior pattern, y'all. And so we are challenged to ask God to interrupt that process to allow us to know what it really means just to serve Him because of who He is.
Amen.
I mean, just because of who He is. And what He has done for us, mm-hmm. It's like, praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Amen, Rachel? Amen. Even with that, you know, there is a song that says, I'm coming back to the heart of worship,
yeah.
Right?
Yes.
And we have to think about what that really means. Because true worship comes from the heart.
From the heart.
It is not pomp and circumstance.
Yeah.
It's not just what feels good,
yeah.
Because if we're being really honest, y'all, there are things that feel good, sound good, smell good, look good,
yeah.
And ain't no kind of good up in them.
Yeah. Amen.
I mean, yeah. I'm just going to keep
That's
it
right.
real,
That's
right?
right?
And it, unfortunately, it's in the church, too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We get caught up in the emotional experience. We have a great time. Mm. This is wonderful. But where was that connection, that emotional depth with God?
Mm-hmm.
Because if that's what's missing, then this is nothing but fluff.
Mm. Yeah.
If I don't have God's truth, His love rooted in my heart, then I will be led astray by any other thing that looks good, by any other doctrine that sounds good,
yep.
By any other word that might make me feel good. And it won't be good.
Right.
We will have that special song, Mike, because we will say, Lord, I knew you.
Yeah.
I didn't have to study all of the counterfeits because I knew the real thing.
Yeah.
I knew the real McCoy. So I was able to keep my mind stayed on thee. And that's what gives us a new song. That's why you can go in and read the same verse and same story. 50 times later and have a new moment and be like, woo,
right? Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Where all you can do is what Jose said earlier,
hands up.
Hands up.
Yeah,
hands
right.
up.
Right.
I am surrendering to God.
Yeah.
I am praising God. I am celebrating my victory even though the battle's not over yet because I know who the winner is.
Right.
It's coming from the heart, y'all. And it's just so exciting, not scary, but exciting because I know who God is and I know He's for me. And as long as I'm with Him, I'm good.
amen, Rachel. Someone
amen.
Said that God and me makes the majority. And so, like, and I'm good with that. One thing real quick. So, Dr. Wells, you read a text. Y'all, the Bible is real. Yeah, let me break that down a little bit. I'm saying it's real because the Bible is speaking truth to us. You heard what it said, Dr. Wells, that first, the first text you read. The word said, you know, it was comparing God to the little gods. Like, these little stuff, that means nothing. It just calls it out. It's like we are serving little G's that have no power. And so God calls it out. God calls us, look, I am the big G, right? I'm the one. And so I thought that was really, for me, it was kind of funny, but it was like, man, you know, God, you are the truth. You are the truth. You are the truth. You are the truth. All right, Dr. Wells?
Amen. And so now we're going to talk about, Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? And this comes from Psalm 15, which I'm going to read, a psalm of David. And it says, O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent? Who shall dwell on your holy hill? He who walks blamelessly and does what is right and speaks truth in his heart. who does not slander with his tongue and does no evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his friend. Verse 4 says, in whose eyes a vile person is contemned, but he honoreth them that feareth the Lord, he that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not, who does not put out his money at interest and does not take a bribe against the innocent, he who does these things shall never be moved. And that is a description, as David is saying, of those who may abide in the tabernacle of God. Those who will abide in the tabernacle of the Lord will live in the righteousness of Christ and have his character in their hearts and reflect it in their lives. We have to remember that even though we're sitting in a sanctuary right now, we are the sanctuary of God.
Yes.
Thus, everything in our lives should be consecrated to him. I know sometimes we think about the building as being holy, but we ourselves must be holy and consecrated to him. We should be holy, not because we ourselves are holy, but because God dwells in us and his holiness shines through us. This is so important because I think that as we see what's happening in the world around us, it is so important for us to have that personal relationship with God, as people have talked about on the panel this morning, because when we don't have that personal relationship with God, we are going to be tossed to and fro. I don't know what's going on with my speech this morning. Maybe I need some more sleep. To and fro, help us, Lord Jesus, by every wind of doctrine.
Yeah.
And in order to be able to, because remember, Satan is not going to just come out right and be like, ha, 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 here I am.
Yeah.
He's going to come with truth and error mixed together. And so we have to be able to understand. And the only way we can do that is by abiding in the presence of God daily and allowing him to live through us. Because the law reflects the likeness of the character of God, keeping the law reflects the image of Christ in our lives. We have to remember that the law is a reflection of Christ. And as we live it out and allow God to live it out through us, we are reflecting the image of God in our lives. And I know people don't like this word, but perfection. Perfection. Perfection, right? Because we can be perfect, not in our own selves, but in Christ.
That's right.
Perfection is understanding our own limitations, surrendering to God, and allowing him to live through us. We live in fear or reverence to God and submit wholly to his will. The problem why we can't attain perfection in Christ is because we're still holding on to our own will. And we've got to completely surrender it to God, because that's the only way that we're going to obtain perfection. Perfection is in Christ alone. And when people tell you that we're going to keep going on sinning till Jesus Christ comes, you better tell them, I am going to be perfect and not my own strength and my own power, but in the perfect will of Christ. Because that is how we obtain perfection. So how do we submit wholly to God? Psalms 51, 2 through 10 says, and I'm going to try to read it fast here, it says, wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part you will make me to know wisdom. purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. This is how we abide in the tabernacle, by staying in constant connection with Christ and allowing him to live in us, his sanctuary. And so I'm going to give it to my panelists and ask them, what other thoughts did you have about, Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle?
I'll just go very quickly here. You know, when we hear keeping the law, we hear perfection. Even in that, you know, Psalm 15, it's only five verses, but it's like, don't do this, people who do that, look out for this, be here, right? And it starts to, or let me not say it starts, it's easy for us to start feeling like, I have to do these things in order to earn God's favor. Yeah. I have to, you know, I have to not do and can't. And we start to get the ick. We start to feel a little bit, you know, sideways, because I want to do what I want to do. And that's why submission is so important. Because just like when you have a child, they have things that they want to do. And it seems totally fine in their mind, in their eyes. But you as the parent, the aunt, the grandparent, the uncle, the teacher, you see, but maybe not. We have a limited insight. We have a limited foresight because our minds are not like God's. And so there are going to be times that he says, hey, look, here's the rules. Here's these guidelines. And we can go into this place of feeling, oh, I don't want to. But if we switch our mindset and say, Lord, it's not about me doing these things so that I can earn favor. It's about doing things so that I can be closer to you and avoiding things that will separate me from you. We have to switch that mindset. God gives us instruction. As you said, Elder Duncan, obedience is important because it's not about keeping us bound. It's about giving us a true sense of freedom.
That's right.
I don't got to worry about the cop coming behind me if I'm doing the speed limit. Right? There's a sense of freedom, right? There's a sense of freedom that comes. And we can be easily misled to the other gods that feel some other kind of way and make you feel like this is nice, but that's not where it is. And I'll tell you guys to go read Psalm 115. I won't read it now, but if you go through verses 3, and it talks about, oh, they have these idols of silver and gold. They got mouths, but they don't talk. They got ears, but they hear not. They got noses, but they smell not. In verse 7, I love it, says, they have hands, but they handle not. God is the one that handles. He gives us our stuff so we can be handled in a good way. Let's not go to the wrong one.
That's right. Amen. I love that, man. That's real. That's real. Sister Rachel, I was thinking, sometimes we create these artificial solutions, you know, police officer, you know, doing the speed limit and not being pulled over, breaking the law. I had a thought when I was driving down to Montgomery, you know, I put my Waze on. And so I have some artificial security. And a lot of us are resting in artificial security when it comes to the Lord. We're worshiping God with no hands, with no feet, with no mouth. And we really think that they're doing something for us because we haven't got the consequence that we probably deserve. You know, so Rachel, talk to us about declare his glory among the nations.
Man, declaring his glory among the nations. Guys, God is good, and he is greatly to be praised.
Yes, he is.
Right? Our commission is not just to have God in our hearts, but to share the love of God in our hearts so that others can be invited in to that experience and to that worship. this lesson highlights Psalms 96. Now, we read that already, so we won't go back and read it now. But please follow along, because if you look, it talks about these different aspects and elements of God. And when we really think about worshiping something, as we mentioned earlier, it's about acknowledging what that thing is. If you worship something, it means that you have a certain level of respect, a certain level of admiration, a level of awe, because this thing is not like any other. It's not like anything else. And so God in Psalm 96 is highlighted as our creator, our king, and our judge. Those three elements point to our past, this present, and the future. You see, when we remember God as creator, we remember that this world would not be here without speaking of his voice. He simply said, let there be. And so it was. If I fully recognize God as creator, then what earthly thing do I have to fear? What situation do I have to worry about when I am facing death's door? I need not be afraid because my God is the creator. If there's one thing that I saw with my mother-in-law, oh Lord, this woman was a pinnacle of health. She had cookbook on health and the health message. She lived her life in ministry and service. And you say, but how does cancer riddle her body in such a way? How do we get here? And we hope and we pray. We say, God, can't you do a miracle? Can't you do this? But part of the miracle was that she was okay as long as she was. And the miracle that I think that is going to touch so many, and I know touched my life, was that though her body faltered, her faith never did. Though her body failed, her God never did. Amen. She remembered him as her creator. She prayed and thanked him for the pain in her life. And that example is how we thank him for the pain in our lives now that she's not here. We remember him as our king in our present. We serve him. We worship him. He is sovereign and Lord and ruler over all. And we look to our future knowing that not is he only our judge, but he's our righteous judge. He knows the inner workings of our heart, right? That old show, who knows the shadows that work, the evil that lurks in the hearts of men. The shadow knows. God knows. He knows what is going on, our moanings and our groanings. He knows, and he will judge us based off of the love that he has for us, the good that he wants for us, and the relationship that he knows we have. And if this anything sounds a bit familiar, it's also highlighted in Revelation 14, as Ella Duncan mentioned earlier, when we look at the third angel's message. Because here again, it says, here's our battle cry. Here is our battle cry. Where it says in verse 6, I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen. It's fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of her wrath and fornication. And the third angel followed and said with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or his hand, that same shall drink the wine of the wrath of God. So don't do it. Which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in presence of the holy angels and the presence of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth forever. Rest no, none, day or night, who worship the beast in his image, whoever receiveth the mark of his name. Take heed, because here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. That is where we see, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. You from henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors.
That's right.
And their works will follow them. I pray that your works will follow you into the courts of heaven, that we may rest in our God and the goodness and fullness of his love as our Creator, our King, and our righteous Judge.
Amen, 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 amen. You know, what a testimony, too. You know, I think about, you know, we kicked this off early. We talked about the importance of practicing. And so in our lives, there's just going to be situations and circumstances that happen, like life will go on. And what happens is, I love the testimony of your mother-in-law, of mom, and just how her faith was anchored. Do y'all hear that? It was anchored. And so God has given that gift to us through her. And others, you've known other folks who have gone through and are going through right now, who are holding on to their faith. When those opportunities show up in our lives, those are times to practice our faith. Those are times to practice our faith. You know, there's a question. When God does not delight in sacrifices, Mike, say more.
When I looked at the title for Thursday's outline, it really intrigued me. And the psalmists make it very clear that there are circumstances under which God rejects sacrifice when God does not delight in our, quote, worship. First of all, we need to remember why the sacrifices were necessary in the first place. There would be no need of sacrifice if it were not because of S-I-N. So what does God want? Our sacrifice? Or does God want our obedience so the sacrifice becomes unnecessary? Second, we need to remember who the sacrifices represent. Remember, they were to bring a lamb that was tamim. In other words, a lamb that was unblemished. And one of the corruptions of the worship service of the Jews in the Old Testament was that they began to bring whatever they wanted to bring, as opposed to a spotless, perfect as possible lamb from the flocks. In other words, they would give to God their leftovers as opposed to giving to God their best. So motivation enters into it. Psalms, the 40th chapter, it is God's desire to write his law in our hearts. That's what the new covenant is all about, spoken of in the book of Hebrews. And what that means is that we learn to love to do the very things that we ought to do. You know, I laughed out loud when I read Psalms 50 and verse 9, where the Lord says, I have no need of a bull from your stall. You keep reading the passage, and the Lord says, if I was hungry, I would not tell you about it. In other words, there's nothing that you can bring to me or give to me that is going to enrich me, because the Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. In other words, God owns everything. One of the key passages in Thursday's outline was Psalms 51, which thankfully Dr. Wells read a portion of. And remember, Psalms 51 is the psalm that was written by David after his double demonic sin of adultery and then attempting to cover it up through murder. Purge me with hyssop that I may be clean. Wash me that I may be whiter than snow. It's very interesting. When you get down to the 14th verse, David says, deliver me from blood guiltiness. But if you read it in the NLT, what it says is, forgive me for shedding blood. In other words, David is specifically asking the Lord to forgive him for the murder of Uriah the Hittite. And so our confession and our repentance needs to be specific. We need to acknowledge the very sins that we are guilty of and recognize that God has abundantly made provision to forgive us for those sins. One of the things that's emphasized under Thursday's outline is that the psalmist, just like the prophets, decry various misuses of worship. And one of the key things that I'll simply say in that context is that worship is not a substitute for righteousness. Praise is not a substitute for obedience. It is a means to an end, not an end in itself. And this is the situation in which God does not delight in sacrifice, when our worship does not lead to a relationship of obedience to him.
That's good.
Throughout the history of Israel, they were repeatedly falling into the sin of idolatry. Mm-hmm. And the sin of idolatry essentially is using God as opposed to serving God. In other words, God becomes a means to an end as opposed to an end in himself. I thought of the statement. This comes from Great Controversy, page 572. She's speaking of Protestant Christians. She says, what they seek is that which is least spiritual and least humiliating. What they desire is a method of forgetting God that shall pass as a method of remembering him. And then she adds these chilling words, the papacy is well adapted to meet the wants of all of these. In other words, Catholicism is specifically designed to accommodate those who want to use God as a means to an end, as opposed to worship and serve God and live with him forever. You know, it's ironic in Matthew, the 15th chapter, where Jesus said, this people draweth nigh unto me with their lips, right? They worship me with their mouths, but their hearts are far from me. I did not know Jesus was actually quoting Isaiah chapter 29. And it's all about a worship that does not genuinely come from the heart, because it does not manifest itself in obedience to God. Knowing the truth is not sufficient. A theoretical knowledge without an experience will never satisfy God. You know, remember in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, if you come to the altar to offer your gift and you remember that your brother has aught against you, he says, leave your gift. First, go be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift. In other words, the relationship is more important than the ritual.
That's right.
And the ritual without the relationship is rejected by God. I'll leave it at that.
Amen. Amen. Have mercy. Listen, we serve a God who loves us, but he's serious. Yeah. I mean, he loves us. I mean, he loves us with everything in him. And I love that text. You know, it's like, man, really, God loves us. He doesn't need us like that, y'all. Right? And so, and I think it's hard for some of us to really reconcile that, and that he, because of who he is, has chosen us, and that's enough. And he loves us. And he sacrificed everything for us. What a powerful study. What I want to do right now is just have the panelists to begin to offer some closing statements for us. And so we're going to start with Dr. Wells, and then we'll go with Rachel, Michael, and then I will close us out, okay? And Rachel will close us out also with a word of prayer. And so we don't have our mic set up. I know there was some, we had some audience members who want to make some comments. And so we don't have our mic set up for that right now. And let's see real quick. All right, go right here, real quick, brother, go ahead. You got to speak up though, so we can. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Listen, thank you for that comment. We appreciate that. The words of encouragement. Panel, real quick, let's keep our remarks really, really brief and go right ahead.
All right, I just wanted to say that, you know, the Lord does not delight in outward sacrifices. And so we need to dedicate our hearts, our minds, our thoughts to God so that he can consecrate them to himself. And that as we live in the righteousness of God, his perfection will live out in our lives. And so may we every day worship God in spirit and in truth. May we live in his presence every day, and may we be reminded that no matter what we are going through, we worship God anyway.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Adding to that, true worship is rooted in truth. The two cannot be divorced That's right. of each other. True, pure worship cannot be based in false doctrine, because the faulty beliefs will taint everything, every gift that we give, every sacrifice that we make, every moment that we spend. All of these good deeds, sure, but God will end up saying, I don't know you, because he didn't have the heart connection, relationship, depth with you. Every single part of all that we do it because of our influences and our intention. So let us be influenced by God. Let us be intentional about setting our sights, taking captive every thought and thinking on these things, that our heart may not be led away from God, but may follow him through every circumstance.
Amen.
Amen. Counterfeit worship is the essence of the mark of the beast. In the Old Testament, it was referred to as Baal worship. What is the modern equivalent? Baal worship is the worship of self disguised as the worship of God. Let me say it again. False worship, Baal worship, is really the worship of self disguised, pretending, masquerading as the worship of God. The good news is, Desire of Ages, page 668, if we consent, he will so identify himself with our thoughts and aims, so blend our hearts and minds into conformity to his will, that in obeying him, we shall be but carrying out our own impulses.
Amen. Amen. Let that be our closing comments. Listen, thank you so much for listening and dialing into the conversation. You know, if you have decided to give your life to Christ, please reach out to us. There's going to be some information to show up on the screen as we close out this session. Reach out to us, and may God bless you. We're going to ask this Rachel to close us out with prayer. And thank you so much for dialing in. And thanks to our those who are in our audience for participating as well. Rachel.
Let's bow our heads. Dear kind and heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you. We thank you for everything that you are. Lord, we ask simply now that you will help us not just to recognize who you are, not just to see the fullness of who you are, but to experience Yes. it, Lord. Let our worship be true worship. Let our hearts be set on you, not because we're seeking some good reward, but because what else is our reasonable response? You have done so much, and we praise you because we know that you will do much more. Thank you, Lord. Please bless every single home and heart represented here, those online and those in person. Be with your children. Be with your people. And let us as your sheep know your voice. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Listen, thanks for coming out. For those who are in the neighborhood today, drop by from 4 o'clock until 6. We have Passion Chicago taking place at Shiloh. It is going to be epic. Thank you very much. Take care and peace.
My voice, O God, in my prayer, preserve my life from fear of the enemy. Hide me from the secret counsel of the wicked. From the insurrection of the workers of iniquity.
From falling. Amen.